The first round of the Madness featured the first place Hawks up against the fourth place Bullets. There was an upset. The first place knocked out of there. Bullets advance. Second round of the Madness featured the second place Kings versus the third place Sixers. Sixers out, Kings advance. Big dance come down to the second place Kings and the fourth place Bullets. And it's my pleasure and honor to introduce to you all for the very first time your 2016 MNBL champions. The mighty Kings have returned. The Kings, baby! To my far right, that's your far left out there, kiddies. Head coach Chris Rogers, congratulations,
thank
brother.
You, thank you very much.
Behind every good man, there is a better woman. To my immediate right, which is your immediate left out there, kiddies, Mrs. Teresa Rogers.
Thank you.
Congratulations. To my immediate left, which is your immediate right out there, kiddies, 3-year man, former Rookie of the Year, Marcos Sequeira. Congratulations. And the far left, with your far right out there, kiddies, old friend who have made MNBL history for winning a title with not one team, not two teams, but three teams. Three teams to match the three dozens. Cliff Williams, congratulations, brother.
Thank you,
down the roster. Gutenberg Santos. Gutenberg, give it up for Gutenberg. Tyrell Genty.
Yeah.
Sam Fassay. Sam, I had a conversation with your brother. We're going to talk about that during the show. Hebert Desane, where's Hebert Desane?
Hebert is working. Couldn't make it tonight.
You know what? Rumors had it, because I have Twitter, that Hebert Desane is actually down in Disney World holding it down for the team. So Hebert's in Disney World. Hebert in Disney World. Tykel Charles. Give it up. Yeah. Sean Gonzalez. Jaquan Tan. And I love Walter. And also on the left coast, we miss you. We miss you very much. Coach Glenn Higgins.
Yep.
This one's for Glenn. You won it.
Yep. This one was for Glenn.
Oh, talk to me. 15 years between titles.
15 long years between titles.
Rumor has it you win titles every 15 years.
I hope it's not another 15 years for the next one.
Chris, tell me about this season. This has been a solid squad. You guys have been in the mix from the opening jump to the final whistle when you took home this title.
Oh, yeah. When we had our draft, we drafted a lot of good guys. And we knew right from the beginning that we were going to probably be right there in the mix of things. That was the plan. We had a plan. And it's good to see when plans come to fruition.
Tracy, my dear, I'm not going to ask you any questions. But whenever you want to say something, you tug me, because this is your show. You know I got a lot of respect for you. And I'm a little afraid of you, too. So you think I'm not showing you any love, you stop me.
Okay?
But I'm not going to ask any questions. Okay?
Thank
because you know I love you.
I love you.
If you wasn't married to him, you might possibly be married to me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're only joking down here. I have respect for the Rogers. And your husband even made good on those Army men several years ago.
He did.
Cliff,
yep.
Buddy.
Yep.
Three titles, three different teams.
Yep.
You took a season off. And you came in this season.
Yep.
Why the Kings? Why not go back to the Sixers, or why not reunite with Gary Rogers on the Sonics? Why the Kings?
I mean, me and Chris go way back. You know, we've always been maybe a little bit, I don't know, competitive or whatever, but
just a wee bit.
You know, they needed some help. You know what I mean? And Glenn had probably already known that he wasn't going to be here or whatever, so we thought the transition would be cool. You know, and I loved working with him, and we work pretty good together. You know, Glenn was the vocal one, the loud one, right, Sam? But seriously, I mean, I loved working on this team, and this was a lot of fun, you know?
And you come into a situation where you're the assistant, so you're not the head coach, so there are certain responsibilities that the head coach have to take on, and you didn't have to worry about those responsibilities.
Right, and I did that for a long time, like, I don't know, 10 years or so, 12 years ago, something like that. And part of the reason I came back was because I knew, you know, obviously Chris could handle all the head coaching stuff or whatever. And after taking a year off for health reasons last year and all that, I really wanted to come back, but every once in a while, you know, I mean, guys can just drive me crazy. So I just wanted to make sure that I was good, that I didn't have to be everywhere all the time. But we helped each other out. I did the concession. He did the L lock thing. You know what I mean? Glenn did the charity things that we did. So it all worked out pretty well.
Marco Sequeira, I was in the war room a couple of seasons ago when Chris Rogers and Glenn Higgins drafted you. They drafted you, they said that you were the future and that they were gonna build a team around you. So 3 years later, former Rookie of the Year, multiple All-Star selection, now you're a champion. You brought a title to a team that only had one banner. Now you have two, and you're one of the main reasons why they have two. So talk to me about your experience. I mean, and watch your language, young man.
This is a great team, you know. We have a good score, Sam. We all contributed as a team, work hard in practice. It feels good to win a title. That's all I can say.
Very good to win a title. And the particular 1-2 punch that stood out the entire year, the Robin to your Batman, Gutenberg Santos. The mic, Mr. Santos, tell me about this season. Point guard for the Kings. You know, being a point guard for the Kings is not an easy job because you have Coach Glenn Higgins in your ear.
Yeah, most definitely. Tykel all year was bringing up the ball, and when he was out, you know, I tried to do my best to bring it up for us. It was a pretty good season this year. It was very good, actually. We won. I didn't even know if I was going to play this year, but then I just decided let's do it and ended up with this team. It was a great team. I got along with everyone. And I'm just happy that we actually won.
Tykel, the other guy that was bringing up the ball during the season, you know, talk to me about this season. You are a champion, brother.
Well, last season, Coach Glenn and Coach Chris, they said next year come back with vengeance because you have to step up.
Now, did you buy into that? Did you buy into that? Did you believe them or did you just... Well, yeah, let them talk.
I believed them. Okay, good. I kept on practicing, and they wanted me to step up this season, which I did, and won the chip.
Tykel, we got a Tyrell, so I just talked to Tykel. So, Tyrell, all these ties, you know, whatever happened to John and Jimmy?
Those days are long gone.
You're a champion, brother. Talk to me about this season, please.
It's my first year playing, and I really like it.
First year playing, and you got the gold.
Yeah, I'm really happy. I'm happy I got picked on this team to play, and it really means a lot because basketball is a lot to me. So I enjoyed it. Enjoyed the season with these guys. Get the chip.
Jaquan Ton, pass it down to Jaquan. I want to hear from you. I want to hear from you, brother. I have to tell you something. You are such a silent assassin. And this is just due to my stupidity. I didn't even realize you were on the team until last week. Only because you're so quiet. You have all these personalities here. You're just so quiet, but you're just like, I like your game, brother. Tell me about this season. Moving on to Sean McDonald. I'm already playing around. You can grab the mic. You know, you can grab the mic. We have plenty of time for you to get in what you need to say. Sean, brother, first year?
First year, yeah.
Sophomore?
Sophomore.
Oh, man, tell me about
Junior.
Where were you last year, man?
I helped.
Oh, you hear him, Chris?
I wasn't being too lazy, you know. Yeah, I helped coach for Al Locke with Coach Macca for the Lakers, and we ended up winning a championship there too. So.
And you know what? We're going to talk about last year's ALBL with the Lakers, but before we get into that, I want to get into Sam Fasse. Sam, first year senior, correct?
First year, baby.
Look at that. First year.
Well, Sam, let me ask you a question. And you know what? This is your show. You can do whatever you want, brother. But Sam, I have to ask you a question. Where were you your sophomore and junior years?
Sophomore, I played JV.
Oh, I didn't even realize that.
Yeah, in junior year, I had a blown knee, so.
Oh, okay.
I didn't even play ball. But, you know, senior year, I had to come back. Do it for the Kings one time, you know what I mean? 15-year drought, you know what I mean? Do it one time, you know what I mean?
That's what I'm talking about. The lineage and the pedigree that you have here, Sam. Sam is the younger brother of Danny Bateau, who was on the 2009 championship Pistons. And right when you guys won the title, and I gave Danny all the dap in the world, and he was smiling, and I said, Danny, who team is better, your team or this team? And you know what his answer was to me? Nestor, you already know what the answer is. I don't even believe you asked a question like that. Insinuating it was his team. Now, I know that you've seen
both.
You've seen both.
I've seen both.
Realistically now, who's the baller in that house? This is your show. Danny?
Danny's the ball in the house.
Bro. Okay.
Yeah, he's the ball.
Is Danny outside waiting for you? I mean, Danny's
outside. Ryan Hall.
He got a closet full of trophies from a young guy. So I think that's what makes me want to play basketball. I wasn't really much of a basketball fan until I saw like how, you know, successful he was off of so many trophies, different leagues, and he just hopped everywhere. Wherever he went, he shined. So he has a lot of trophies, you know. And I wanted to go out and get myself one, man. So I had to do it for one time.
And you got it. And you got it. You got it. Now, to the man who last year was on the ALBL, the Al Locke Champions Lakers, to first year Kings. And Chris, he happened to be your nephew.
I didn't know he was a champion for the Al Locke.
Wow. Yes, he's a double champion.
He's a double champ.
He's a double champion. Walter, how is it to play for your uncle? You know, he was there when your mama brought you home from the hospital. He's seen you go through many a diapers.
I thought it was a great opportunity and a great experience. Him as a coach was a really nice time to really connect and get better, like have a better time to know him. Also with the team, I thought the team was a great experience. Everything kind of worked well. Everything kind of worked. I mean, went well. Well, it had to. We won the championship, so.
Tracy, he's very well spoken.
He is very well spoken. Must take after me.
Absolutely, I was thinking that, but I didn't want to go there. I don't want to go. Walter, I am famous for giving out nicknames. But you came into this league with a nickname that I did not give you. Reverend Bernard Stroud gave you that nickname. Would you like to tell the live viewing audience what that nickname is?
Gerber baby.
And he named you that literally the day that they brought you home.
Yeah.
And you know what? You do kind of resemble the Gerber baby, but you know what? You are the champion. You are the Gerber baby. Our champions. Head coach Chris, that first game, thank you. That first game against the Sixers. Very difficult to beat one team three times in one season. And you had to change up the game plan. You had to give them a different look. You just beat them for the second time a week earlier.
Yes.
So what is it? I mean, you can let us know. How did you prepare your men?
Well, we practiced hard and we went over different scenarios, what they might try to do to us. And if you remember, when I was on the show with Coach Chris,
yeah,
he sort of gave out some secrets. So I sort of knew what to look for, because he said, hey, we're going to go box one on Marcos. So instantly, we're going to practice for box and one on Marco.
Yeah.
We ran different scenarios of what they might run at us and everything else. And I knew these guys were ready. They always looked ready. They were focused. Great group of guys. Gentlemen. Mm-hmm. Pleasure to have on this team. And I just knew they had heart. They definitely had heart. They were ready. They were ready.
Cliff.
Yep.
The team that you guys beat to get into the championship, the Sixers.
Yep.
Those two seasons are gone. That you were head coach of the Sixers.
Yep.
You've had some players that you drafted was on that team. Yeah. So tell me the emotions. Obviously, you want to win with the Kings.
Yep.
In the perfect world, you could have brought those Sixers players with you. But it don't work that way in the MNBL. So tell me about the emotions, that because you were in a very unique position, having been a head coach of a team, drafted players, but then within two seasons later, you're going up against that very team for the richest prize in all of recreation sports in the city of Malden.
Yeah. I think I want to say there were three guys left from when I drafted Lynn and Gene and who was it, Monteros. Mm-hmm. And they all got so much better, you know. But I always, right from the start, me and Chris had faith in this team the whole time. Couple of things I wanted to say. First of all, very proud of the way Sam stepped up in that last game. Mm-hmm. 5 minutes left, he turned into a totally different person. He was on the floor, you know, grabbing rebounds, all that stuff, and that probably pushed us over the edge at the end of the game. My man Goose hit 4 free throws, stuff like that. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. they played like men, you know? And, I mean, let's face it, the guys that are graduating, you know, after this year, that's pretty much what they are. They're out in the world and all that stuff, and they got to step up. So I'm really proud of them, the way they came around and all that. Quick story, we were in the draft, and after we had picked Sam, you know, we had some guys in mind and all that, and it came to our second pick, right?
Yeah.
And we were like, damn, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And like in the back of our heads, all three of us, we knew there was someone we wanted to take. And for the life of us, we couldn't remember who it was. For some reason, no one wrote it down. So we're looking at the monitor on the flat screen we got, the little laptop. And number 5 walks by, and it's Goots. Mm-hmm. And all at once, we're like, hey, that's the dude right there. That's him. And we ended up drafting him. And I think that was a big deal, along with the other pieces that we got. That made a huge difference. I don't know if we'd be sitting here right now if we didn't, you know, by chance, you know what I mean? Thank God for technology, you know? Otherwise, we might have been stuck. But he just happened to pop right into the screen.
We were looking at it, like, damn, that's the dude right there.
That's him. And it worked out perfect, you know? It worked out great.
And, you know, Cliff, you talk about technology, and when Glenn Higgins first brought out the concept of recording the tryouts, everybody laughed at Glenn. Because usually people laugh at Glenn anyway. with Glenn. We're all joking around the fraternity. But everyone laughed at Glenn. But that became the norm. Glenn Higgins introduced that, Chris.
Oh, yeah, because we talked about it. And we was like, hey, we should film it. Do you got a camera? He's like, oh, I got a camera. He started filming. Now, like you said, everybody was laughing. Mm-hmm. Now everyone, you look at the trials, everybody's got their phone. They got their camera.
Actually, you get laughed at if you don't record it.
That's right.
That's right. It's so easy now with the smartphones and stuff, you know, but so many times you go back and you forget what a dude looks like. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Everyone blends in after a while. You're watching, looking at 80 kids or whatever. You kind of forget, you know, but now you got the little camera. Everyone's got their camera at the draft. They're going through. Works out pretty good.
This is the time when we're going to go into the predictions. The very first show this year of Around the Rim. We're going to roll this in and you all are going to witness who I picked was going to win this thing. Hashtags, that's the Domus. Let's roll it, please.
Think I got it.
In the first round, I see the Hawks coming in first place.
Okay.
And the next three teams, Brad.
They all can't come in second.
Are so equal. They all can't come in second, but I see the Kings coming in fourth place.
Okay.
So the first round, we have the Kings and the Hawks. And the second round, we have the Bullets and the Sixers. And at this point, it doesn't matter who comes in second, who comes in third.
No, it really doesn't.
First round, I see something that last time it happened was 1994. I see an upset. I see the fourth place Kings taking out the defending Neighborhood League champs.
Wow.
And yes, wow is right.
Tweet it.
Use usually you make predictions like this when it comes to a certain team, the Kings.
Yeah.
This year, it's going to be me. So you'll probably do, you'll probably follow suit. I don't know, but I'm laying.
Wasn't the, in the agenda.
I'm laying the groundwork first.
All right.
And you and I never talk about this. So
never.
You're hearing this the first time as the rest of the viewing audience.
It's like picking Super Bowl squares. You just never know.
So in the second round, Bullets, Sixers. It's going to be a close, close game, but.
That's a good game, actually.
The Sixers are going to beat the Bullets. So then we have.
Wow, second year coaches going to the big one.
They're going to the big dance. So then we have the Sixers, the higher seed Sixers, going up against the lower seed Kings.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to have a damn good basketball game. All right. Mm-hmm. But the coaching experience of Chris Rogers, Glenn Higgins, Cliff Williams, between the three of them, that's like 99 years of a coaching experience. I'm going with the upset, and I'm going with something that has only happened once in 1988. I see the fourth place Kings taking the whole doggone thing, Brad.
Wow.
Kings are my prediction, Brad.
Really?
Yes.
You haven't picked the Kings in 27 years.
I never picked the Kings.
Never.
Well, no, I picked them in 2001, 2001.
You did?
Because there was only two real teams in that.
Yeah.
It was the Kings, it was the Pistons, and everybody else was just jockeying for draft position.
The Pistons beat the Kings three times that year.
In fourth place, but hashtag Nestodomus had the Hawks, had the Bullets, had the Sixers, had the Kings. Hashtag Nestodomus did say that the Hawks, first place Hawks, wasn't getting out of that first round, but most importantly, the Kings are your 2016 MNBL champions. And gentlemen, the coaches, when you handle your business and come on this last show as the new reigning defending Neighborhood League champions, you leave with gifts.
Oh, I like gifts.
You like gifts? So the gifts I have for you two gentlemen is that I have your playoff game against the Sixers, and I have your championship game against those Bullets.
Oh, nice.
So nice. The coaches get the goodies, and it's the coaches' responsibilities to make copies for anybody on the team. And Glenn Higgins, hashtag, this one's for you. I got yours, buddy, and right after this show, I'm mailing it out to you, brother. This one's for you.
Nice.
Tracy, you hear that music?
That's, yeah.
Yeah, that's Whitney Houston. I'm Eddie Miller. This is March. It is, right? This is March. Women's History Month.
Yeah,
International
that's right.
Month of Women.
Yep.
So we're going to shout out women.
Okay.
More specifically, the mamas. We're going to shout the mamas. So, Marcos, when your mama asks you to do something simple as make your bed, don't give it a gas face. Just make your bed. Gutenberg, when your moms ask you how your day was in school,
tell her.
Don't give her. That's what I'm talking about. Hand me Cliff. Hand me Cliff. Don't give her one-word answers. Just answer the question. Don't say fine. Oh, I had this day in school. I had that day in school. And I love Walter. When your mama comes to the games and wants to talk to you at halftime, wants to talk to you at in between periods, whenever there's a timeout, don't ignore your mama, because your mama knows that you're ignoring her. Gentlemen, your mama's brought you into this world, and she can take you out. Hand it to the mamas. Before this show winds down, I have a list of crew members that I want to thank, because if it wasn't for my crew members, I would be sitting here in the dark, talking to the cameras, looking like a real dummy. So, first of all, I want to say a heartfelt get well soon to Back in the Day Buddy. Back in the Day Buddy directed the first several shows of this season, but then illness took to him, and for the past month, he could not be here. So, Back in the Day Buddy, get well soon, okay? Second season, who was here every show, laying down the audio, Spizzy P. So, thank you, Spizzy P. Thank you, and get well Back in the Day, buddy. My right-hand man, Big Game.
holding down the directorial duties when back in the day Buddy could not come back. So big game, thank you. First season crewers, Reliz, T-Sounds, here every week. Amy the equipment hun, who apparently could not make it tonight, but Amy. Dirk nor Andy, thank you. Second season, and the person who received the torch from Waldo, Jazzy Josie, holding down the main camera. Also second season, being the media tech stepping up to that position, making sure that my cameras are all set, that there's never, ever, ever an eyes and teeth production. Young Stevie Dub, you know what I'm talking about. With over 25 years of community television experience, right on, Ron. And finally, last but never least, the person who has been with me since day one and recently had to leave, my man, Waldo Wigglesworth. Waldo, thank you for all your years of volunteerism. Chris, I got to get this question out, and you basically have like 90 seconds to answer this. Championship game against an old nemesis, the Bullets. How do you prepare for that game? How do you make sure that Steve Wright, because you know he goes over bullet history. How do you make sure bullet history doesn't repeat itself?
Like I said earlier, these guys were focused. They knew. They had the mission in their hands. They knew what they had to do. Although when I played in the league, Steve Wright was beating me up. beat me up a few times throughout the years, but I knew this team was ready. They were ready to win this championship. We talked about it. We practiced about it, and they were ready. There was no practice. There was nothing that Steve could do. Prepared for us.
Yeah. Very good. And you know what? This is the quickest half hour of the season. And I just want to say thank you and congratulations again, Chris Rogers.
Nestor, thank you. Hope to see you next year.
I hope you're here next year. Tracy Rogers.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Marco Sequeira.
Thank you. Cliff Williams, man.
It's a pleasure.
It's a pleasure. And I'm going to come down here and shake all the champions' hands. And I'm going to have them be quiet because
this is the song I've been waiting for.
So, Wavis Notches, Hooches Cooches, I came in peace, I leave with love. This is for the red, the black, and the green, and I'll be seeing you in 2017.